Hello, welcome to the Black Ponder. I'm Neil Trotter. Now, I haven't made a video in a while. Now, it's true, I've been a bit busy with my day job. I mean, that's certainly the case. But primarily, the reason why I haven't made a video in some time is because I've been busy reading what's known as the Bible of the Working Class. It's Karl Marx's Capital, Volume 1. Now, what this 1,000 plus page tome is a critical analysis of capitalism. It's Karl Marx's theories about the beginnings of capitalism, how it starts, and its effect on society. And let me tell you, what a joy to read, because Capital Volume 1 is a great example of practical philosophy, really, because not only does Karl Marx throw out a bunch of philosophical ideas and concepts, but he backs up those concepts and ideas with hard evidence. Half of this book really is a history lesson on the beginnings of modern day capitalism, the Industrial Revolution, primarily in Europe, but also in America, and a little info here and there in Asia. And I like that. That's very refreshing to me when a philosopher throws out ideas and then backs them up with hard historical references. Not all the great philosophers do that, actually. And Karl Marx does that, so I appreciate that. That made the book quite enjoyable to read. But let's get right down to it. Let's go to quote number one already. Let's dive into this bad boy. Let me read you this. In general, the greater the productivity of labor, the less the labor time required to produce an article, the less the mass of labor crystallized in that article, and the less its value. Inversely, the less the productivity of labor, the greater the labor time necessary to produce an article, and the greater its value. The value of a commodity, therefore, varies directly as the quantity and inversely as the productivity of the labor which finds its realization within the commodity. So Karl Marx is saying basically capitalism starts off with commodity, like paper or, you know, a book or a pencil, music CD, whatever, you know, any type of commodity that you can sell. But those commodities are produced by labor. So that's the key thing. Labor is what produces commodities, and commodities are what's sold, and that's the basis of capitalism. So it all starts out with labor, and that's very important to understand, because labor is from whom? It's from people. So he's humanizing capitalism already. He's making it about people. Very important, right? Let's continue. Value, therefore, does not have its description branded on its forehead. It rather transforms every product of labor into a social hieroglyphic. Later on, men try to decipher the hieroglyphic, to get behind the secret of their own social product. For the characteristic which objects of utility have of being values is as much men's social product as is their language. The belated scientific discovery that the products of labor, insofar as they are values, are merely the material expressions of the human labor expended to produce them, marks an epoch in the history of mankind's development, but by no means banishes the semblance of objectivity possessed by the social characteristics of labor, something which is only valid for this particular form of production, the production of commodities, namely the fact that the specific social character of private laborers carrying on independently of each other consists in their equality as human labor, and in the product assumes the form of the existence of value, appears to those caught up in the relations of commodity production. And this is true both before and after the above mentioned scientific discovery, to be just as ultimately valid as the fact that the scientific dissection of the air into its component parts left the atmosphere itself unaltered in its physical configuration. So what's being said here? Basically, the value of a commodity is hard to determine, right? It's a strange combination of human labor and the relativity of commodities. So far, no chemist has ever discovered exchange value either in a pearl or a diamond. The economists who have discovered this chemical substance and who lay special claim to critical acumen nevertheless find that the use value of material objects belongs to them independently of their material properties, while their value, on the other hand, forms a part of them as objects. what confirms them in this value is the peculiar substance that the use value of a thing is realized without exchange, i.e. in the direct relation between the thing and the man, while inversely its value is realized only in exchange, i.e. in a social process. So what's being said here? Basically, there's two types of value. There's use value, right? This is what Karl Marx is saying, and then there's exchange value. Let's take, for example, a water bottle. Now, a water bottle has a lot of use to it, right? You can carry water in it, and water is essential for life, right? It's very useful. Now take, for example, this gold pendant, right? This isn't really gold, it's just metal painted gold. You know, I wish I was that baller, but no, let's pretend this is a gold pendant, right? Now, what use does this have? Not much, right? This is a lot more useful than this. So there's a value right there. However, if this was actual gold, this necklace is actually more valuable than this bottle of water. That's exchange value. There's two types of values. One is determined by the use of a commodity, and the other is determined by its rate of exchange. But again, we have to consider it's all about labor, right? Labor is a huge determinant of value. The amount of labor that was necessary to make this water bottle is less than the amount of labor that's necessary to make this supposedly golden pendant. So because more labor is necessary to make that gold pendant, it is more valuable than that bottle of water, despite the fact that the water bottle is more useful than the gold pendant. That's an important thing to remember as we continue. Money necessarily crystallizes out of the process of exchange, in which different products of labor are in fact equated with each other, and thus converted into commodities. The historical broadening and deepening of the phenomenon of exchange develops the opposition between use value and value which is latent in the nature of the commodity. The need to give an external expression to this opposition for the purposes of commercial intercourse produces the drive towards an independent form of value, which finds neither rest nor peace until an independent form has been achieved by the differentiation of commodities into commodities and money. At the same rate, then, as the transformation of the products of labor into commodities is accomplished, one particular commodity is transformed into money. Now, money is used to express this exchange value. That's the point of money. It's a way that we can quantify this exchange value. But it doesn't necessarily relate to the use value or the objectivity of the commodity. Money, like every other commodity, cannot express this magnitude of its value except relatively in other commodities. This value is determined by the labor time required for its production and is expressed in the quantity of any other commodity in which the same amount of labor time is congealed. This establishing of its relative value occurs at the source of its production by means of barter. As soon as it enters into circulation as money, its value is already given. The price form, however, is not only compatible with the possibility of a quantitative incongruity between magnitude of value and price, i.e. between the magnitude of value and its own expression in money, but it may also harbor a qualitative contradiction, with the result that price ceases altogether to express value, despite the fact that money is nothing but the value form of commodities. Things which, in and for themselves, are not commodities, things such as conscience, honor, etc., can be offered for sale by their holders, and thus acquire the form of commodities through their price. Hence a thing, formally speaking, have a price without having a value. The expression of price is, in this case, imaginary, like certain quantities in mathematics. On the other hand, the imaginary price form may also conceal a real value relation, or one derived from it. As for instance, the price of uncultivated land, which is without value because no human labor is objectified in it. I remember one time I was at a clothing store and I was looking for sweatshirts, like workout sweaters, like something to work out in, something that I could do some athletic activities in. And there was two sweatshirts. They're pretty much almost the same. One was $10 and one was $50. They were the same color, they were the same size. The only difference was that one had a Nike logo check on it. That was a $50 one, and one didn't have one. That was a $10 one. This is what Karl Marx is talking about when he's talking about imaginary value. Let me use another example. Think about a mainstream music versus independent music. An indie artist, an indie musician, he might make his music, or she might make his music, or the indie band might make their music in a garage using recording equipment that they bought in some electronics store, and they can come out with some music that's pretty good. Now with more mainstream music, the artist is under a record label, and that record label has a recording studio where the cost to record is like maybe $200 per hour or something like that, and it's got like top of the line production equipment. The music label is also able to make a music video that they can put on MTV or whatever, and then also the music label can put their song on blast, like every hour you hear their song. Now, the difference between the music is the music from the mainstream artist better than the music from the indie artist. Could be, could not be. It kind of really doesn't depend on that. It's just for some reason that mainstream artist has music that's more valuable than the independent artist. It might cost more to buy their CD than it would be the indie artist, even though the music might not be as good. The user is most rightly hated because money itself is a source of his gain and is not used for the purposes for which it was invented. For it originated for the exchange of commodities, but interest makes out of money more money. The transformation of money into capital has to be developed on the basis of immanent laws of exchange of commodities, in such a way that the starting point is the exchange of equivalents. The money owner, who is as yet only a capitalist in larval form, must buy his commodities at their value, sell them at their value, and yet at the end of the process withdraw more value from circulation than he threw into it at the beginning. His emergence as a butterfly must, and yet must not, take place in the sphere of circulation. These are the conditions of the problem. So Karl Marx is saying that's the problem. That's where capitalism starts to go out of hand. See, the thing is, there has to be some profit made, right? The money you put into a commodity, you can't just get that money back. You gotta get that and some more. You can't just break even, right? Going back to the mainstream artists, that record label put a lot of money in that, the production of whatever album that artist is doing, right? A lot of money was put into that. Now, the record label doesn't want to break even. Oh, no. They want to make a lot of money off of that. That's the problem right there. That's when capitalism starts getting out of hand. This is what Karl Marx is saying. The labor process may continue beyond the time necessary to reproduce and incorporate in the product a mere equivalent for the value of the labor power. For this, 6 hours alone will be sufficient, but the process lasts longer, say for 12 hours. The activity of labor power, therefore, not only reproduces its own value, but produces value over and above this. This surplus value is the difference between the value of the product and the value of the elements consumed in the formation of the product, in other words, the means of production and the labor power. In presenting the different parts played by the various factors of the labor process in the formation of the product's value, we have in fact characterized the different functions allotted to the different elements of capital in its own valorization process. The excess of the total value of the product over the sum of the values of its constituent elements is the excess of the capital, which has been valorized over the value of the capital originally advanced. The means of production on the one hand, labor power on the other, are merely the different forms of existence which the value of the original capital assumed when it lost its monetary form and was transformed into the various factors of the labor process. So Karl Marx is beginning to develop this philosophical idea of surplus value, the idea that the point of capitalism, or the capitalist, the person with the money who's buying the commodity, their goal is to get more value than the money they put into it to produce it. That's the goal, that's the point. This process, this creation of surplus value, of getting more value out of the money you put into the labor that was paid for to make the commodity, that's called valorization. That's Karl Marx's term. By an unlimited extension of the working day, you may in one day use up a quantity of labor power greater than I can restore in thee. What you gain in labor, I lose in the substance of labor. Using my labor and despoiling it are quite different things. You pay me for one day's labor power while you use 3 days of it. That is against our contract and the law of commodity exchange. Karl Marx is saying how capitalism works is that you pay a laborer a certain amount of money to make a commodity, but that capitalist is getting more value out of that commodity than what he paid the laborer, right? It's not an equivalent exchange is what's going on. And how could it be? Because if it was an equivalent exchange, the capitalist would break even, right? The capitalist would gain nothing, right? Because it'll be a fair exchange. But that's not the point of capitalism. The point of capitalism is to make a profit, right? And the only way to do that is to not pay the laborer the equivalent of the value of the labor that he put into making that commodity. Ultimately, is an exploitation of the laborer. This is what Karl Marx is saying capitalism is. The length of time during which he utilizes this labor power is divided into two separate periods. During one period, the worker produces a value that is only equal to the value of his labor power, i.e. he produces its equivalent. This the capitalist receives in return for advancing the price of the labor power, a product of the same price. It is the same as if he had bought the product ready-made in the market. During the other period, the period of surplus labor, the utilization of the labor power creates a value for the capitalist without costing him any value in return. He is thus able to set labor power in motion without paying for it. It is in this sense that the surplus labor can be called unpaid labor. Capital, therefore, is not only the command over labor, it is essentially the command over unpaid labor. All surplus value, whatever particular form, profit, interest, or rent, it may subsequently crystallize into, is in substance the materialization of unpaid labor time. The secret of the self-valorization of capital resolves itself into the fact that it has at its disposal a definite quantity of the unpaid labor of other people. For example, let's think about how much an actual, like, iPhone, how much an iPhone actually costs, right? $500, $600 about. I mean, iPhones are pretty expensive, maybe $400 if you get it cheap, cheap, right? It's a lot. Smartphones cost a lot of money. But let's think about how much it costs to actually manufacture or to make a smartphone, right? Let's think about that. Now, if you actually paid the laborer, the person that made the smartphone, an equivalent to how much the smartphone is actually worth, okay, people in factories that make smartphones, they'd be rolling in dough. Like, they'd have a lot of money on work on them, right? But of course, they don't get paid nearly as much as what the smartphone is actually worth, right? Most of that manufacture happens overseas, where people are paid, you know, less than minimum wage in America, right? All that surplus value goes to the smartphone companies, right? Because they're making a ton of profit, right? And this is what Karl Marx is talking about. There's a lack of equivalent exchange between the capitalist and the laborer. We may therefore understand the decisive importance of the transformation of the value and price of labor power into the form of wages, or into the value and price of labor itself. All the notions of justice held by both the worker and the capitalist, all the mystifications of the capitalist mode of production, all the capitalism's illusions about freedom, all the apologetic tricks of vulgar economics have as their basis the form of appearance discussed above, which makes the actual relation invisible and indeed presents to the eye the precise opposite of that relation. World history has taken a long time to get to the bottom of the mystery of wages, but despite this, nothing is easier to understand than the necessity, the reason of this form of appearance. The exchange between capital and labor at first presents itself to our perceptions in exactly the same way as the sale and purchase of all commodities. The buyer gives a certain sum of money, the seller an article which is something other than money. Let us consider, on the other hand, the capitalist. He wishes to receive as much labor as possible for as little money as possible. In practice, therefore, the only thing that interests him is the difference between the price of labor power and the value which its function creates. But he tries to buy all commodities as cheaply as possible, and his own invariable explanation of his profit is that it is a result of mere sharp practice, of buying under the value and selling over it. Hence, he never comes to see that if such a thing as the value of labor really existed, and he really paid this value, no capital would exist, and his money would never be transformed into capital. Moreover, the actual movement of wages presents phenomena which seem to prove that it is not the value of labor power which is paid, but the value of its function of labor itself. Listen, I'm not against capitalism, okay? Don't label me as some sort of communist enemy of the state or anything like that. Look, I'm a small business owner myself, okay? You know, so capitalism is okay. What Karl Marx is saying is that capitalism is built off of a non-equivalent exchange, right? Surplus value. To make a profit, you can't pay the laborer exactly the value that he's giving you. Because if you did that, you'd just break even all the time. That's what Karl Marx is saying. What capitalism is an exploitation of the laborer. I mean, that's the reality of the situation. What is the takeaway from this book? Well, we know the reality of what capitalism is. Therefore, we can't allow total, complete freedom. There's got to be some sort of regulations going on, because capitalism, without any type of regulation or control, is just going to exploit the laborer to the point where the laborer is going to be unable to live, right? There's got to be some sort of control, some sort of regulation going on, so that we can keep it in check at least. Half of what Capital Volume 1 is a history lesson on how corporations exploited the labor, used child labor, had people working like 12, 16 hour days, 7 days a week, right? Just exploiting the labor, and how laws had to be passed to prevent the labor from being so exploited. So it's important to remember this for the health of society. We have to remember what the reality of what capitalism is. Whether it's bad or good, I mean, that's open to debate, but we got to remember the reality of what it is. Capitalism is based off of unequivalent exchange. It has to be for a capitalist, a corporation, a company, to make any sort of profit. This is a theory of Karl Marx anyway. I don't know, it makes sense to me. But what about you? Comment below, we could talk about it. Well, you've been watching The Black Ponder. I'm Neil Trotter. Tune in next time for more philosophical thought.